Okay, well, everybody, it's great to see us having such good time fellowship, but let's stop, okay, so that we can, no, I'm just kidding. Oh, really great to see all that. You know, it's always so good to be able to open up God's Word and gather together. I get the privilege most Sundays of being able to teach God's Word, and what a joy it is. We are in the book of 1 Peter, so if you're not sure where that is and you don't have a Bible, just so you know, there's Bibles under the seats in front of you. You should be able to find one. And if you're wondering where 1 Peter is, I'll give you the page number if that's helpful to you. I believe we're at 1014, okay, near the end of the book, okay, so near the end of the Bible. So if you want to turn there. By the way, and if you don't have a Bible, just want you to know that we do have Bibles at the back. Just ask the team that's out there at our guest info area. They'd be happy to hook you up with a complimentary Bible so that you've got one as well. Well, I'm sure you feel this too, but we really live in a day, don't we, where there is... we live in a culture where people really struggle with identity, don't they? I mean, people have always struggled with identity, right? Self-worth, their own identity. But today, more than ever, we have massive challenges throughout our world about identity. But that problem of identity is something that not only is outside of the church walls, but it's actually also inside the church walls. Sometimes, as churches, we don't always know who we are either. There are Christians in the church sometimes who don't know the church. They don't know what the church is all about. And frankly, we live in a day where there's so much confusion outside of the church, in society, about church. And quite honestly, I can see why that exists. I trust that you can too. I mean, it's confusing when people hear about, for example, so many different denominations, isn't it? I mean, when we lived in Utah and planted a church in Utah, we deliberately avoided ever talking about denominations because with the religious culture that existed, it was unbelievably confusing. It's confusing when people hear about a Baptist church, for example. I mean, goodness, have you ever seen online how many types of Baptist churches there are? I mean, there's free will Baptists, there's regular Baptists, whatever that means. You know, and then there's the Baptist Union. I mean, that's just to name a few. And then there's a whole pile of others. Evangelical Free, Christian and Missionary Alliance, Mennonite Brethren, Lutheran, Methodist, Anglican, and on it goes. And that's just like a few of hundreds, literally hundreds upon hundreds of denominations that exist. I mean, if you're outside the church, you're looking into the church and you're going, I have no idea where to go. It's so confusing. It's confusing when people see so many different logos all over the place. Don't get me wrong. I like logos. Don't get me wrong. I like church names. But, you know, we have so many different church names. We have a name, don't we? Harvest Bible Chapel. But nowadays, it's really interesting in the last number of years how many strange names have come out for churches. Have you noticed that? I mean, whatever happened to the old days when it was like, let me give you the name of our church, Highland Park Church. Whoa. Bro, that's so crazy, creative. Highland Park Church? I mean, come on. But let me give you some of the strange names that are out there now. Fierce Church. Brave Church, Axiom Church, and I kid you not, in Toronto, Canada, James Bond United Community Church. Apparently named after somebody named St. James, okay? He happened to be St. James Bond, but I tell you, I wonder what their logo looks like. Here's a great one, Waterproof Baptist Church. This is a great one. I mean, this tells you maybe a lot about the theology. Country Club Christian Church. Or how about, this one's a great one, First United Separated Baptist Church. I'm not sure how you get united and separated at the same time. But here, how about this one, Accident Baptist Church. I mean, talk about, so wait a second, so where's the sovereignty of God in that church, right? It's just an accident. And then, of course, there's always the First Baptist churches, right? But then there's the church that comes along and decides, you know, we're going to be a little more spiritual. We're going to say we're greater Second Baptist Church, right? And then, of course, there's Living Hope or Little Hope Baptist Church, Little Hope Baptist Church. Lover's Lane Episcopal Church, the new aggressive church of deliverance. I mean, come on, I want to come to that church. And then there's, you're going to love this one, Flippin' Church of God. Hold on, before you think too much of what I just said and go, what are you saying, Cory? It's a place. It's in Flippin', Arkansas, okay? It's a Flippin' Church of God. I'm thinking that's where I wouldn't go with the name of the town I live in. So it's so confusing out there, right? Like people in terms of our identity, who that we are, what they see. It's confusing actually to enter into churches, isn't it? Only to find such a wide assortment of styles and preferences and approaches and methods, from suits to shorts to full bands to choirs and robes. But people holding scripture in one text that says, "Be still and know that I am God," like it's holy if you don't move at all. To dancing in the aisles and everything in between. We have such a range and a variety. It's literally Baskin-Robbins 31 flavors and more. It's confusing when people on the outside see certain churches accepting certain cultural practices as well, isn't it? And others rejecting those practices. And boy, it's really confusing nowadays to those outside the church when they see some who are in the church hitch their wagons, especially as evangelicals, to political leaders. It's caused so much confusion. The truth of the gospel gets so muddied, especially at a time like this. I recently had a conversation, guess where? Starbucks. With about five people, because they just honestly, sincerely wanted to know, like, tell me about the church where you're at as a pastor. Like what kind of church are you guys? And I said, well, we are an evangelical church. And I said, now hang on a second. Let me just explain what I mean by that. So I proceeded for the next five or so minutes to say, I want to be clear with you about what an evangelical really is. Because I even almost don't even want to use that word today, quite honestly. Even though that's what I am, that's what we are. Because that word has now become a dirty word in so many ways. People have taken the word in terms of what that meant historically, and it's so diluted and watered down. And so now what we have out there is every Yahoo under the sun who puts a video on Instagram or wherever, or every TV preacher out there still claiming to be evangelical, and I don't want anything to do with them. Nothing. Nothing to do with them at all. They're not really, in my view, what represents true evangelical churches. You see, what is a real evangelical church? And I was able to share with them, a real evangelical church, it boils down to this. The evangel is the gospel. It's about the good news of Jesus Christ. An evangelical church is just a church that takes the Bible as God's word and preaches the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's an evangelical church. We hold that near and dear. That is our identity. That is who we are. It was a really helpful conversation. In fact, it was quite clarifying for many of them. You see, because all they do is see things on TV and hear things around them, and they never really get a chance to really rub shoulders with a real evangelical. And when I say really evangelical, I'm not much for titles, and I'm not much for names, and not much for any of that stuff. I'm not much for denominations. I really couldn't care less about a denomination, quite frankly, with you. What I want to do is I want to follow Jesus and what the Bible teaches. And I know there are some who will put denominations before everything else. They want to wave the flag of their denomination as if it's all that and a bag of chips, and it's not. So in the midst of all this confusion over who we are as a church, that confusion is also inside the church as well. Sometimes Christians, we don't know who we are either, and we have to go to Scripture and define ourselves according to Scripture. What does the Bible say about who we are? Now, who we are, according to God's word, is in part laid out for us in our text this morning in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 through 10. It is a snapshot. It's not the full picture of who we are as a church, but what Peter has to say is so powerful because he's writing to a group of believers who are scattered all throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, these exiles who are like strangers living in a strange world where they don't really fit in and they don't really belong anymore, it feels like, and that the sort of religious persecution they're experiencing is kind of like this sort of soft form this early stages of persecution where they're being maligned and ridiculed, and they are probably sitting out there in sort of no man's land, wandering around, wondering, who in the world are we? And Peter weighs in. Let me tell you who you are. Let me tell you who you are as exiles. You see, it's so easy to attach who we are to a particular location or a particular building or something like that. And Peter will blow our minds this morning in terms of what actually God says about who we are. Because it absolutely has nothing to do with our location, has nothing to do with our building. Although we're grateful for where we live and we're grateful for our building. So again, if you're following in 1 Peter, on page 1015 roughly, I'm going to take you through three things that Peter tells us about the church, three things that are really important for us as well. In fact, I think some of these things may, in fact, some of you to go, I'm not so sure, Cory, but that's good, especially the third thing. But let's talk about it. So number one, of the church, I want you to see that Peter says that we are the new temple. We are the new temple. He says this in verses 4 through 8. He said, as you come to him, a living stone rejected by men, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious, you yourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. So the honor is for you who believe. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble because they disobey the word as they were destined to do. 1 Peter chapter 2. Peter here in these verses is describing how we, that is the church, collectively, not just in this one location, but actually scattered throughout Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Bithynia, and California, and New York, and Chicago, and wherever else in the world, we as the church are this new temple. That's what he's telling us in this text. You can imagine how shocking that would be back in the first century when we think about the other temple that existed in Jerusalem. Now, to understand how the church is the new temple, it's helpful to understand a little bit about the Old Testament temple, isn't it? Because that's what Peter's doing here. He's writing to these individuals, and certainly this is in their mind. So much identity for the Jew was attached to the temple, and so much identity to the Jew was attached to Jerusalem. And Peter is saying, as scattered exiles, here you are that new temple. In Exodus chapter 25 through 40, Moses was given instructions by God to build the tabernacle or the temple that he was to build, where God's presence would come in and dwell in that tabernacle. The very end of chapter 40 tells the account of where God's glory came in the temple structure. He appeared, manifesting himself. And Moses built this temporary tabernacle, and then years later, if you think about it, a temple, an actual temple was built, referred to as the house of God, built by Solomon in 1 Kings chapter 5 through 8. We can read the account of that. And at the completion of that temple construction, Solomon said, I have indeed built a magnificent temple for you, a place for you to dwell forever. Temple was of enormous significance to the Jews. It was a physical temple, a magnificent structure located in Jerusalem. It had an outer court and it had an inner court. And inside the inner court was the Holy of Holies. That is where God would appear. That's where the high priest would go once a year and once a year only on the Day of Atonement known as Yom Kippur. And he would go in there and they would have a rope tied to him, and that he would go in, because if he was struck dead by going in there and encountering the presence of God, that they could yank him out because nobody could go in and get him. You see, it was this temple that God would appear in. He would come in his glory. And non-Jews, they could not really enter into the temple. those who were outside of Israel could be in the outer court, the court of the Gentiles, as it was called. Well, it's this temple that was built by Solomon that gets later destroyed when the Babylonians come in 586 BC. And they destroy Jerusalem, they destroy the temple, and they take people like Daniel off into captivity. And they did that because Israel had sinned against God. And God's glory removed, he removed his glory from the temple. He departed. But then after 70 years, as promised, God brought the people home. The temple was rebuilt, but not to its former glory. Those that remembered the past, what the former temple looked like, mourned because they knew how glorious it was. This one wasn't measuring up. But nonetheless, the temple was rebuilt. And then years later, under King Herod, Roman king, the temple was rebuilt. And then in 70 AD, it was obliterated. It was destroyed. All of that is a background to our text. You see, in our text from 1 Peter 2, verses 4 through 8, Peter tells us that the Old Testament temple has now given way to the new temple, the church. Now, why is that? We don't have the time to go into all the details of this, but I would suggest to you that if you were in Matthew chapter 21 through 24, if you were to go there and you were to read carefully through that, what we discover is that in Matthew chapter 21, Jesus comes into Jerusalem riding on a donkey. We call it Palm Sunday. It was his declaration to Israel that he is the king. The king has arrived. What he was doing was in perfect alignment with all Old Testament kings who would ride in on donkeys, and the people would blow trumpets, and they would hail the king, and they would announce that the new king is here. And Jesus was proclaiming himself to be king. But the people responded, some of them favorably, but a lot of the religious establishment at the time did not, especially the Pharisees. And so from Matthew chapter 21 and 22 and 23, Jesus has a series of altercations, if you will, with those religious groups, the Sadducees and the Pharisees and scribes and such. He engages them in conversation. They ask him a number of questions, seeking to trap him. He tells them parables and stories, and he has some questions of his own that he asks them as well. And in all of those, he makes it very clear to them that you, religious leaders, you are rejecting me. You are the builders. You're the builders, but you have rejected this cornerstone. You have rejected me. And as a result of that, he says in Matthew chapter 21, verse 43, "Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing its fruit." So here is Jesus showing how they're constantly rejecting him. Rejection, 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 rejection. You come to Matthew chapter 23, and Jesus pronounces all these judgments upon the religious leaders of that time. "Woe to you, woe to you, woe to you. Judgment is coming, judgment is coming, judgment is coming. It's right around the corner." And he ends in chapter 3 by saying in verse 38, "See, your house is left to you desolate." Your house. Not their individual homes, but rather the temple. You see, after all of those years with the temple, all of those years, we now come crashing into Matthew chapter 24. And as Jesus is with his disciples and he exits the temple area, verse 24, verse 1, Jesus left the temple and he was going away. When his disciples came to point out to him the buildings of the temple, right, they're kind of like in awe. "Jesus, look at this magnificent structure. Look at this building." Jesus answers them, "You see all of these? Do you not? I say to you, there will not be left here one stone upon another that will not be thrown down." Now, some of you are probably going to really say, "You know, I completely disagree with you, Cory, on that," and that's okay because there's room in the kingdom for disagreement. But I'm going to say to you that in my perspective, Matthew 24 is talking about the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. And that Jesus is saying to the nation of Israel, you have rejected me, rejected me, you've rejected me over and over and over again. I have come to you as your king and you have rejected me, but the kingdom is being handed over. It's being handed over because you, the builders, have rejected me, the cornerstone. And because you've rejected me, Jesus would then say to them in the parable of the fig tree, these words, he said, may you never produce fruit again. Never. And Jesus is saying that they will never actually produce fruit again. Now, Jesus is not done with Jewish people. No, that's not what he's saying. But he's done with the temple. It's over. It's finished. Why? Because Jesus, at this point forward, is now building a new temple. A new temple that consisted of people. You see, the old temple is coming down. The religious leaders were all about the old temple. The disciples were, Jesus, look at these magnificent stones. And Jesus says, there's not going to be a stone. And some of them were 2 to 5 tons in weight. There's not going to be a stone that's left on another. That's all coming down because I'm going to build a brand new temple. And with this as our background, let's look now what Peter says about that new temple in our text. He says, as you come to him in verse 4, as you come to him, who is he talking about? He's saying to the recipients, to people who are reading his letter, as you come to Jesus. But who is the him? Who's here? We say it's Jesus, and it is Jesus, but let me be more specific. You see, just before this, the verse just before this, it says, if you've tasted that the Lord is good, you're coming to the one who is the Lord. As you come to the Lord, it's good. Now, if you were to chase this down in the Old Testament, this phrase, tasted that the Lord is good, you would find it in Psalm 34, verse 8. And right there in that text, you know who the Lord is there? It's capital L-O-R-D. It's Yahweh. It's the one true God. Here in this text, Peter is saying, as you come to Yahweh, as you come to the one true God, you have come to him. He is the living stone. You want to talk about stones. You want to be enamored with something that's a building and a facility. That stones are 2 to 5 tons. You can go ahead and do that, but you should be enamored rather with the living stone. He is the one you come to for salvation, you see. So what does it mean for Jesus to be that living stone in this text? The idea of Jesus being a living stone is that really it's probably a reference to the fact that he's a risen Savior, that he's alive, that as the living stone, he conquered death. Our text tells us that he was rejected and he became the cornerstone in God's new temple. If you're to read this in particular in verses 6 through 8, you can see that it says, for it stands in Scripture, behold, I'm laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. So the honor is for you who believe, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble because they disobey the word as they were destined to do. So here you have Peter telling us that Jesus, who's the cornerstone, or he's the living stone, he's both the living stone and the cornerstone, that certainly in his day he was rejected, wasn't he? The builders rejected him. You can see that in Matthew chapter 21. Peter tells us that Jesus was rejected. He was despised and rejected. But not everybody rejected him. Those who were receiving 1 Peter, this message, they had accepted him. As you come to him, a living stone, that's what they did. They came to him. And as they came to him as a living stone, what did they become? Living stones. Living stones. Now, I want to talk for a little while with you about the structure of this new temple, because we get a little introduction to the structure of this new temple here in this text. And did you know that the structure of this new temple, God's sort of structure, if I can put this, is biological. It's a biological structure. That's what it is. It's actually not a physical structure. It's a biological structure because it consists of people. I want you to notice a few texts, and we'll walk through these texts as they tell us about what the church really is. In Ephesians chapter 2, verses 19 through 22, Paul said, so then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. Amazing passage, isn't it? Paul then in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 says these words, "Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him. For God's temple is holy and you are that temple." Now I want you to know that in that passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, when it says in this text, "Do you not know that you," the word "you," "are God's temple," that word "you" is plural in Greek. You see, we read this from a sort of very Western viewpoint, don't we? Where we read it and we say, "Yes, Lord, I'm your temple." And that's true. Okay, there's truth to that. We are his temple. Chapter 6 of 1 Corinthians talks about it on a personal level. We are the temple of the Spirit of God. The Spirit lives inside each of us as followers of Jesus. But in chapter 3, he's saying here that you as a church are God's temple. Because God is here among you. His Spirit is here when you gather. His Spirit is among you. That's the beauty of the temple. So from these texts, from 1 Peter chapter 2 and Ephesians chapter 2 and 1 Corinthians chapter 3, we can discover that God's architecture surely is biological. His new temple, that is the church, is a living organism, actually. It's not an organization, is it? We discover that Jesus here is described as the cornerstone and the living stone. The apostles and prophets are described as the foundation stones. The believers are living stones being built up in this temple, and the Holy Spirit dwells in the midst. Now, there are several things that are implications that come out of this text for us this morning. For example, the new temple, that is the church, that is us, God's people, scattered throughout the globe, has Jesus as the cornerstone, meaning he's the most important stone in the entire structure. Not only is he the living stone, the resurrected one, but he's also the cornerstone, because the cornerstone of the foundation is actually the very first stone to be put in place back in that day. Since from that one stone, both the angle of the walls and the level of the stone courses would be extended from it. For that reason, the cornerstone had to be perfect. It had to be square and true, otherwise everything would be thrown off. Can you imagine that? Put a cornerstone in, and that cornerstone, everything's supposed to go from that. Can you imagine if it's off somehow? Everything would be wonky, wouldn't it? You'd end up like with a Tower of Pisa or something. I don't know. You see, it is his church, right? He's the cornerstone. He is the most important in the entire church. It's Christ's church, not man's church. It's Christ's church, not my church. It's Christ's church, not your church. It's his church. We are his church. We are his bride. In fact, in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, the Apostle Paul had this to say regarding the church. Just before he talked about the temple, that you as a church, you, plural, are the temple of the living God, he said these words, "According to the grace," this is in chapter 3, verse 10, "according to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it, for no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ." You get that? No one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. "Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, or straw, each one's work will become manifest, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, although he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is holy and you are that temple. Lay no other foundation than Jesus Christ. He has to be the most important." in the church. The other thing to note from this picture of the temple is that the new temple, that is the church, is built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. You know, those prophets and the apostles, and some scholars like Wayne Grudem, for example, would say it's actually apostles, prophets, that is referring to one group, not to two groups. There's a good reason to believe that. The apostles functioning as prophets, they received divine revelation from God, and the apostles were limited actually to the first century, to the 12 that Jesus chose. 12 specific apostles who received divine revelation from God. There's been no other apostles of that nature or that sort since. Certainly there are those who are called apostles in the New Testament, but the word apostle also just means one sent. Not like one penny, but like one sent out, like a missionary. In some respects, some could be considered apostles in a missionary kind of sense, but not in the technical sense of the way that it's used with the 12. Only the 12 served in that role. They laid down the truths of Scripture, and the church was built on the foundation of the Word of God. Jesus Christ is the cornerstone, and the foundation of the church is built upon the Word of God, the truths of God's Word. Do not deviate as a church from Jesus being the center and the Word of God being at the foundation. And then we're told in this text in 1 Peter that the New Testament or the new temple of the church grows. It grows, actually. It's been growing ever since Jesus said these words and Peter wrote these words to the church. It's been growing every single time somebody comes to him. Every time somebody's a believer in Jesus Christ, that's a new living stone that gets added to the temple. Every single day across our globe, there are people that are coming to know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. God's temple is growing everywhere, all the time. And we also discover from the language of the temple here that the new temple, it's not about a fixed location, is it? The temple is not a physical structure. It consists rather of believers in Jesus. So when we speak of the way we do, and we get it, we do it, I still do it even though I know the language isn't correct. When I say I'm going to church, that's actually wrong, isn't it? I'm not going to church. You are the church. We are the church. We're gathering as a church. That's better, right? We're gathering as a church on a Sunday morning. We're not going to church because we're saying, and we do that, we say that we're saying the building is the church. This is not the church. This is a building. And it's so important to sort of understand the difference between that, because this building could be here today and gone tomorrow. But the church will still remain, because the church is about people. And then the New Testament, notice this new temple, I mean church, has the Spirit of God in our midst. So different than in the Old Testament days, where we have the gifts of the Spirit, where we have the presence of the Spirit, and when the Word of God is preached, God's Spirit accompanying His Word. And when we have the church gathered together, like in Acts chapter 13, and they gathered together and they worshiped the Lord and they fasted and they prayed, the Holy Spirit said to those who were gathering, appoint for me or set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I've called them. And they sent them out as missionaries. You see, God's Spirit in our midst gives us guidance and direction, doesn't He? Yes, He does. That's the Spirit in our midst. You see, friends, from my perspective, the Old Testament temple is gone, forever gone. Now, I know some of my end times prophecy buff friends are going to say, well, it's going to be rebuilt, and I'm going to probably say, no, it's not. If it is, that's just because it got rebuilt. It's not because it was part of God's divine plan. You see, God's plan is not to go back to an old temple. It's not to go back to a place where there'll be sacrifices reoffered again. That's all come and gone. Since Jesus came, there's no longer any need for sacrifices. There's no longer a need for any priesthood like they had in the Old Testament. All of that is in the past. The new has come. The new temple is here to stay, as Hebrews makes clear. Okay, now, secondly, of the church, Peter also says that we are the new priesthood. So not only we are the new temple, but we are actually the new priesthood. Notice in verse 4 and 5, he says, as you come to him, a living stone rejected by men, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious, You yourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house. There it is. You're being built up as this temple, right? To be a holy priesthood. To be a holy priesthood. That's what we are. Did you know that? Did you know that you're a priest? You're like, man, I never thought I'd be a priest. I don't even want to be a priest. Well, don't think the priest in the sense of the caller like that. But you are, if you're a follower of Jesus, Jesus says, this is who you are. You're actually, you belong to the new temple. You are also a priest in that temple, in this temple, the church. You are to be a holy priesthood. Now this then, of course, by way of implication, shows us that the priesthood in the Old Testament, it's come and gone. People that want to continue to hang on to that, they don't need to hang on to that because Jesus has come. Hebrews chapter 5 tells us that Jesus is our great high priest. He is of a different priest altogether than the Old Testament priest under Aaron. He is a priest according to the order of Melchizedek, we're told in Hebrews 5 through 7. Hebrews 7 also tells us that the priesthood in and of itself, the whole Aaronic priesthood, is gone. It's gone. It's not going to come back. It's gone because there's no longer a need for that kind of a priest because the priests served in the temple. They were the ones who were there as mediators between God and people. They were the ones who would hear people's sins and they would take the sacrifices and offer the sacrifices as Levitical priests on the altar of God. They were the ones who sort of stood in the gap in those days. In Hebrews chapter 7, we read that if perfection had been attainable through the Levitical priesthood, what further need would there have been for another priest to arise after the order of Melchizedek rather than the one named after the order of Aaron? For when there is a change in the priesthood, there is necessarily a change in the law as well. That's it, you see. The priesthood changed. The law is no longer binding on the believer today in the sense of the sacrificial aspects of the law, the ceremonial aspects of the law. We are not under that anymore. We are in Christ. Priests in the Old Testament are no longer needed because animal sacrifices are not needed to atone for sins because the Bible tells us in 1 Peter 3:18 that Christ died for sins once for all. He is the high priest, paid it all one time. That's it. There's never another need to offer another single sacrifice to atone for our sins. It's such a beautiful thing for us. You see, the Old Testament priesthood, if you think about it, was only for the Levites. Not even all Jews were priests, but the New Testament priesthood is for all believers. We are all considered priests. We're all given access to God. We all can go into his presence. We are all his servants or ministers, if you will, male or female, Jew or Gentile. We've been all called to serve and to minister. And because of that, may we never be cruise ship Christians. You know, the kind, the cruise ship Christian who sort of like to come into the church and they might enjoy sort of living on the top deck, right? But never get involved in anything, never kind of do anything in serving or giving of themselves. But they like all the sort of the top deck things. I mean, frankly, in your cruise ship, I mean, you're going to be on the top deck. If you pay to go on a cruise, that's where you want to be, right? You want to be where all the sun is shining. But the reality is there's people that are way down below, down in the bowels of the ship. We got people in the bowels of the ship here. Bowels of the ship. You're rowing. You're working hard. Thank you for your service and your ministry. But sometimes you still got to get topside, don't you? You sure do. And some of you are on topside need to go down below the deck a little bit. Lean in and serve. God has called you to serve out of joy for what he has done. So don't be a cruise ship Christian because you're called to minister. But not only are we this new priesthood, I want you to note in verse 5, what we're supposed to do as priests. We are to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. That's what we're called to do. Who are we? We are a royal priesthood. We're like king priests. That is our identity. You know, it's so important to think about who you are and to not only think about it, but to claim that is true. If that's what God says you are, claim it is true and believe it is true. You know, claiming something just because the health and wealth gospel claims stuff out there, You know, if you're claiming things that are in Scripture, that's a good thing, right? You're claiming what the Word of God says. If the Word of God tells you very clearly that you are a royal priesthood, then claim that. You might say, well, I don't feel like a royal priesthood. I don't feel chosen by God. But well, you are. So believe it and claim it. Accept what God says of you. And because you're a royal priesthood, then you offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God. And I'm sure we're so familiar, many of us, with this incredible text in the book of Romans in chapter 12. In fact, probably many of you already in this room have already had your mind already turned there and review the passage when Paul said, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercy of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. So we offer ourselves to God now. You see, we're not offering up an animal to atone for sins. This is not about sacrificing for atonement. This is not about appeasing God. Rather, this is about worship, isn't it? It's about presenting yourself, me presenting myself to God, saying, God, I'm yours. I am yours, Lord. I lay myself down at your altar. Hebrews chapter 13, in fact, tells us that we should offer what's called the sacrifice of praise. Yeah. The fruit of lips that confess his name. So we praise God, we sacrifice for him in this way. Of this, Warren Wiersbe said, Christians today do not bring animal sacrifices as they did in the Old Testament, but we do have our own sacrifices to present to God. We ought to give our bodies to him as a living sacrifice, as well as the praise of our lips. The money and other material things we share with others in God's service is also a spiritual sacrifice. Even when the people we win to Christ are sacrifices to his glory. See, this is what we do. You see, one of the fundamental roles of a priest in the Old Testament is to stand and be there on behalf of the people. To represent the people. To represent people who have needs and are broken. And one of the fundamental things that you are all called to do as well as the church is to be a royal priesthood, to serve and to minister on behalf of others, not only those inside the church, but also those outside the church who need somebody to stand in the gap for them, who will minister to them and serve them and care for them and love them and do everything that they can to be able to help to bring them before God as, in a sense, a mediator between you and God for them to help put them in touch with him, the living king. And then the third and final thing that Peter tells us in this text, in verses 9 to 10, he tells us that we are the new Israel. Oh boy, and here we go. Here is the one. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 and 10, Peter says, but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Now, you might be thinking, okay, why that is the point, Cory? Why would you say, I mean, where in this text does it say that we are the new Israel? Fair question. Where does it not say that we are the new Israel? You see, because everything that Peter says here, he says of Israel in the Old Testament. These are declarations that are taken by Peter out of the Old Testament and applied to the church. You know, Israel was called a chosen race. Israel was called a priesthood. Israel was called a holy nation. Israel was called a people for his own possession. That was Israel. This is a description of ancient Israel. In Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 6, he said, you are a people holy to the Lord. He has chosen you to be his treasured possession. In Exodus 19, verse 5 and 6, he said, you shall be my treasured possession, he's talking to Israel, and a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. In Hosea chapter 2, verse 23, he said, I will say to not my people, you are my people. All of this is right here in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 and 10. And what Peter is showing us is that just as we are the new temple and the old is gone, so we are also the new priesthood. The old is gone. This is the new priesthood. And now Israel. Israel now has been, if I can put it this way maybe, Israel has been reconfigured. It's been reconfigured. You see, true Israel isn't just simply about being an ethnic Jew, is it? It's not been that way. Paul made that argument clear in Romans chapter 9 through 11. You can be of Israel without being a physical descendant of Israel. Declarations here are made in the Old Testament about Israel, but they're all applied now to the church. And the church consists of Jews and non-Jews, all peoples. This isn't a text where Peter, who's a Jew, is saying the Jews have no place. He's not saying that. He's saying there has been a reconfiguration. All the promises of the Old Testament now come to bear, and they're fulfilled in Christ, in the church, one body consisting of Jews and Gentiles, all brought together. Here's how Paul put it in Ephesians chapter 2. He said, "Therefore, remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands. Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who are far off and peace to those who are near. For through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit." You see, we are the new Israel. Paul refers to us as that in Galatians 6, verse 16, as the Israel of God. That new man or person that he's created, where the two have now become one, and he calls it the church. And as God's people, Peter tells us that you actually exist for a purpose and a reason. Notice this in verse 9. He says, "You are a chosen race, you're a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that," and here's the purpose, "that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." That's what we're called to do, isn't it? As God's new temple and as his new priests, that's what we're called to do. We are called to proclaim the excellencies of him. We're called to draw attention to how great our God is. We're called to draw attention to his incredible attributes, to really give people an understanding of who our God is. It's about the proclamation of the gospel, telling people about Jesus, isn't it? But it's more than just the gospel, too. It's declaring who God is to people, speaking of how magnificent and wonderful and glorious God is, and so that people would taste and see that the Lord is good, that the world might know him. Just as Israel in the Old Testament was called by the nation to be a light to the nations, a light to the Gentiles, so too the church now is called to be that light to the world. And we do that out of who we are, as the new temple, as his chosen people, as his own precious possession. It's out of that that we serve on mission. It's out of that that we proclaim and make known his excellencies. So friends, who are we? We are the church, aren't we? We're the church that's the new temple, the new priesthood, and the new Israel. So let's this week enter into this world outside of these walls as his new people, or as his people, remembering that as God's people, who we are, that he dwells among us, that he's called us to minister to others, and that we are precious and chosen and holy in his sight, called to declare his praises to all who will hear. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for your truth, Lord. Thank you for your description of who we are. Lord, it's not often how the world would see us, that's for sure. But it is how you see us. Out of how you see us, Lord, would you help us to live? Would you help us to live as the kind of people you want us to live and serve and give of ourselves? Thank you, Lord, for your love for us, that you have chosen us, you've set us apart, you've made us holy, you've called us your own treasured possession, and Lord, that you've called us to declare your glory. We want to do that this week in Jesus' name. Amen.